Blog Talk Radio.
Excuse me, yes sir, I understand, but do you actually have the word yes in your vocabulary?
Ladies and gentlemen, that is my theme song. I just want to thank everyone. This is Off the Chain. I am your host, Yvonne Mason. And for those of y'all that have been following this show since its inception, y'all know why I play that song. So many people down through the years said, nope, you can't do it. You're not smart enough. You're not bright enough. You're too old. You're too short. You're too this. You're too that. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you what. I thank every one of them for telling me no, because things that have happened in my life are just absolutely amazing. In spite of, well, maybe it was because they told me no. I went through the numbers this morning. I didn't do all the podcast numbers, just did some of them because, as most of y'all know, my husband is going through radiation treatments, and we have to leave pretty early in the morning to get him over to the radiation place. Just on this show alone, ladies and gentlemen, we have reached 89,176 listeners. Now, the show's not even 2 years old, and we're almost to 90,000 listeners. And behind that will be 100,000 listeners just on the show. And I want to thank Australia because y'all are the ones that have been with me since the inception. They are our biggest listening base. And because of that, I like to promote some of their hometown boys. It's a group called the Teskey Brothers. If you have not yet heard them, go look them up. They are a blues band. And they need sound like they need to be on Bourbon Street in New Orleans and not down under. They're a mixture of Johnny Lang and Eric Clapton and B.B. King and Robert Johnson and Otis Redding all rolled up into a nice, neat type package. So check them out. Now, when you add all the podcast, and like I said, I haven't done that in a day or two, but the last time I added up, we had 110,000 podcasts that it goes up on, which is iTunes and YouTube and TuneIn Radio and FM.com and SoundCloud, Mixcloud, Podcast, Podcast.com, Podcast Garden, Spreaker, Stitcher. You name it, and this show is up there, and we're heard in over 100 countries. So there's two ways that you can get on the show. You can email me at offthechainradio@yahoo.com and say, hey, Yvonne, I've got a platform. I want to get on the show. Or you can go to advertisecast.com and look up Off the Chain and look at my rates and place an ad because I will run it for 30 days. No matter how many shows I have in that 30 days, I will run your ad. And in fact, I have two ads to run tonight. The first one is Inside Your Life with Cece. Cece Chamberlain has a wonderful podcast, and it's full of thought-provoking interviews, which are motivational and inspirational, and they're to inspire others and fill up the soul with feel-good stories and conversations to strengthen the mind, body, and soul. For many of us, inspiration and motivation is few and far between. But with Inside Your Life with Cece, the podcast is a glimmer of hope in a world full of confusion and discouraging times. You know, just plain old tough days. Some days we just crawl out of bed and look the sun in the face and go, really? Another day? Cece's interviews will entertain you, lift you up, and bring the absolute best out of the world in you. So go to www.podcast.com/InsideYourLifeWithCece. She is also on iTunes and Google Play. So there's no reason for you not to be on the show, ladies and gentlemen. Either go to AdvertiseCast.com, look up Off the Chain Radio, and send me your ad, or send me an email at OffTheChainRadio@Yahoo.com and say, Vaughn, I want to be on your show, because this show is filling up fast. We're already booked through the middle of June. And by the time I get everybody else that have already sent me the information, we'll probably be up close to the end of this year, which is starting out with a bang. That being said, I have this wonderful, wonderful guest who has been so patient with me. And when I say that this show builds on itself, because it's not my show, it's your show, it's my listener's show, it's the guest show. I could sit here and talk all night, nobody would care. But this show builds on itself. And I know that some of you have heard my guest, Wayne Zarrell, when he comes on. He lives up in the mountains of Tennessee now, and he's absolutely fantastic. Love him to death. Well, he got so excited about being on the show and sharing his stories that he went out and got a friend of his, who is also an author, who is also a transplant, who's one of the nicest people you would ever want to talk to. And she writes some pretty darn good books, too. Her name is Cheryl Peyton, and she is a Chicago native who retired to a lake and golf community in Loudon, Tennessee, which is just right outside of Knoxville. She retired there with her husband in 2004. And a professional work experience. Now, are you ready for this, ladies and gentlemen? She was a social worker on Chicago's South Side. She was an interior designer on the North Shore and a paralegal employed by a sole practitioner. Now, none of those have anything in common, except maybe the paralegal and the social worker, unless the social worker is going to go in and do interior design and then represent these kids. I don't know, but we'll find out. She wrote her first book in 2011 titled 6 Minutes to Midnight, which is about the theft of a nuclear weapon from a Y-12 shipment by a band of social misfits. She had become acquainted with a former nuclear weapons courier who became her consultant on the project and fostered her interest in researching a subject for authenticity and a fictional story. Since that time, she's written 6 other books, a series of 5 cozy-style international travel mysteries featuring a female tour operator turned amateur a biography of a friend's difficult but untimely successful treatment of paralytic polio. Now, when we talk about killer book, ladies and gentlemen, you will get chill bumps. She and I discussed it briefly. I'm not going to spoil the suspense because you got to stay tuned in because you can't go get her books yet because we haven't told you what they are. So sit back, get your cup of coffee, and welcome the wonderful, wonderful Miss Cheryl Peyton. Thank you, Cheryl, for coming on the show. I appreciate it so much.
Oh, thank you. It's an honor. Thank you.
So let's talk about Miss Cheryl. You had a very interesting childhood. When you were a little girl and you were trying to decide, before we get into the interesting part, you were trying to decide what you wanted to be when you grow up.
Sure.
Did writing ever cross your mind?
Well, it did. I lived in a pretty creative household. My dad was an artist. He was a commercial artist, so he did television commercials. Like, he did the Pillsbury Doughboy and so on.
My favorite.
Was it? And,
yeah.
Well, that was his. And he did all the Kellogg's cereals and so on. So he was an artist, and my mom was a writer. She was actually worked as an editor, but of course she did writing too. So so the arts were discussed in my house, in my family, and so yes, we talked about, you know, going into this or that field that would be involved in either one of their professions.
But,
about, would you want me to tell you about my mother?
Yes, tell us about your mother. Ladies and gentlemen, this story, most of us, if we're read bedtime stories, we're read bedtime stories out of a children's book. You know,
yeah.
See Spot,
yeah.
Run. Run, Jane, run. Yeah. Or the cow jumped over the moon. But not this girl. I wanted to be her when I was little.
Yeah. Well, my mother was pretty unusual in her reading taste for me anyway. For instance, she wouldn't read Dr. Seuss because he made up words. She said, you have enough trouble learning a vocabulary of real words. You're not going to learn false words. So that was one thing. Yeah. So, and then she didn't believe in fairy tales either, because she thought that I should learn more about the real world. So she had her own peculiar ideas of how to, you know, bring up young children. But what she did do that was inspiring for me is that she would bring home the manuscripts that she was editing. She was a editor of trade magazines as well as a young adult Christian literature. So the publishing house that she worked for, she had those two jobs. So fortunately, she didn't bring home Machine and Tool Blue Book, which was one of the trade magazines that she was editing. But she did bring home these young adult Christian fiction books, and she would read the manuscript to me. And as I mentioned to you before, I think partly because she was doing her work, you know, because she would be proofreading and she would be scrawling you know, in the margins as she would be reading to me. But I was just, you know, a little kid, and she would ask my opinion about the story, elements of writing, and she would discuss this with me as a learning device for me, a teaching device for her, a learning device for me, as to what elements make up a good story. And then when she would be reading, for instance, the dialogue between, you know, young people older than me, but they were kids, she would say, "This doesn't sound natural to me. How would you and your friends say this?" You know. And so she would get my input, which was also interesting, because that was provocative and made me think, you know, well, how would you say this in the in natural speech? And that's what I try to do in my books. I always try to have the characters sound like people really talk. They might not use perfect grammar. They might not use complete sentences. You know, as we all talk, it's not as we write. And so, you know, my mom and I would talk about all that, and I would give her my input, and then she would scratch things out, and she said, "Well, I thought so. That's a lot better." And so we would, you know, discuss it. So it was a good learning tool for me to think about the elements of writing, and she did inspire me that way.
Well, from your mom doing that with you as a child, how in the world did you wind up being a caseworker, an interior designer, and a paralegal?
Oh, okay. Well,
that's kind of totally opposite end of the spectrum there.
I know. I seem to be finding myself for about 20 years. You know, who am I?
I understand that.
I know.
What is my purpose?
I came out of college sort of idealistic, you know. I wanted to do something good and make a difference in the world. And I had a friend, actually, who was a caseworker, and she said that you would just have to take a test. I was a caseworker. I wasn't officially a social worker. I didn't have a master's degree in social work. Actually, I had an art degree from college, which was worthless. So you can't go into anything, you know. You're totally outside of the whole economic sphere. If you come out of college with an art degree, you're worthless. So I could have gone to work, I guess, for my dad, but of course I didn't want to do that at 21. So my friend told me about this. So I thought, well, that sounds like, you know, really a really challenging job that I thought would be worthwhile. And so I did that. And I was actually there for 10 years. I became a supervisor after, I don't know, a couple years. And then I was a supervisor of the nursing home application office. And so I, you know, it wasn't just social work. But I was working on the South Side in what were pretty thought to be pretty dangerous neighborhoods. But my clients all protected me. And I had a notebook that had an emblem that said caseworker. And I would sort of show that as I walked down the street because, you know, who wants to bother the golden goose, you know. So it was sort of a protection. And people would watch for me. I'd say, well, I'm going to come and see you tomorrow. I'll be down. I'll come down and look for you. So I never had any problems, except maybe with stray dogs that you have to worry about. You have to be aware.
Because the
might
south
have to
side
run.
Of Chicago is not one of the better areas to be wandering around in the daylight, much less dark, much less being seen.
No, it wasn't even back then. But as I say, you know, I felt protected because people got to know me. And they knew, you know, why I was there, that I was there to help. And so I felt pretty safe.
How did you go from social worker then to interior design work?
Well,
now, that's interesting.
Well, after 10 years, what would happen to a lot of us in social work is that you burn out. You know, you sort of tire because it just grinds on. You're not really lifting people, not many. You're not lifting that many people out of poverty are really doing a lot of good. And so, well, I just felt like I needed something a little more positive in my life at that time. Actually, I also went through a divorce. And so I thought, my gosh, I can't keep going to work and dealing with everybody else's problems. I had enough of my own. So I had taken interior design courses as part of my art background, and I had always had a flair for that. Even as a kid, I used to come home from college and rearrange the furniture in my parents' house. My mother said, "What are you doing?" I said, "The piano should never be on this wall. It's terrible." I would come home and redecorate the Christmas tree. I was terrible. But anyway, so that was always an interest of mine. So I boned up on that. I went to the Art Institute. I took a couple more courses in, you know, the psychology of color and things like that. And I got a job as I had several jobs as an interior designer. I worked for a small place that did custom draperies and upholstery and general design work. So that was a real cozy place for me at that time in my life, and I really enjoyed that and made good friends. There were just, you know, 3-4 of us working together. It was a very nice situation, and I lived in that area. I lived on the North Shore at that point. So I did that, and then I also worked for Ethan Allen, you know, in a different type of operation, selling furniture and doing design work. So I did that. And then I did that for, I guess it's another 10 years. I did 10-year blocks. And then I was remarried, and I was working hours and days when other people are home. So I didn't see my husband very much because I was working evenings and Saturdays and every other Sunday. So, and he was an attorney, so that got my interest. I liked that too. I like a lot of different things. So then I went back to school and got my paralegal certificate and got a job with a litigator in Highland Park. So,
and then, ladies and gentlemen, the whole Chicago thing and brought herself down to the South. Now, let me ask you, Cheryl, when you left Chicago and came to the sleepy town of Loudon, now I'm from Georgia and I have family all in Tennessee, North South Carolina area. Did you feel like you had a culture shock?
Well, yes, of course. I mean, coming from a big metropolitan area, I mean, the speed of life and the landscape, for one thing, I never saw any hills in Chicago. I brought a bike down. I found that I couldn't take it on the hills around here. I used to go for miles in Chicago. You'd never go on a hill. So, yes, the topography, the people are more open and friendly, I'd have to say. I don't want to knock people in Chicago because they're good, too. But people here are friendly. I couldn't believe the first time I stood in line and somebody in front of me turned around and started talking to me. You would never do that in Chicago. You don't talk to strangers in line.
Well, they're only strangers for the first 30 seconds. After that, they're your best friend.
Here, yes, but not, yeah. And I remember our car broke down. I guess we had the lights on when we left the car, parked the car for a movie when we were here, when we first came here. And so we had a dead battery. What, you couldn't believe how many people stopped. We had put the hood up, you know, check on what was going on. And a young woman came by and she said, "Can I help you?"
Yep.
That wouldn't happen in Chicago either. So
welcome
I was
to
very
the South,
impressed
my dear.
With,
welcome to the South.
That?
Welcome
yeah.
to the South.
That's true. That's true. They really extend themselves. And so I liked it. I liked it right away. I've enjoyed living here. And I've adapted. I feel that this is my home.
I was going to say, how hard was it for you to not only slow your thought process down, but your whole demeanor and everything slows down to almost comatose in the South, because that's the way we are. We don't get in any big hurry. If we don't get it done today, there's always tomorrow.
Yeah.
How difficult was it for you to slow your pace of living down?
Well, I had retired just before we moved, so I had sort of gone down a gear anyway. And then I have my own activities. I'm also an artist, so I had joined the authors or the artists guild here in Tellico Village where I live, and so I was painting and busy and active, and I liked the pace. It was a leisurely pace, but I was always occupied doing things. So, and then I started writing, so the pace doesn't bother me. I like it.
Yeah, and I think that we get to a point in our lives, Cheryl, where it's time for us to slow down.
Mm-hmm.
It because, number one, I'm too tired to go fast anymore. The body says,
right.
Watch this. You want to go
me
fast?
Too.
Watch what I'm going to do to you. And the mind's going, but I'm going to get to her first.
Mm-hmm.
Just don't get in any hurry anymore. It's not worth
it. Right.
So let's play this one ad I've got to play real quick, and then I want to talk to you for a few minutes about how you wound up getting on the show, and then we're going to talk about these wonderful, wonderful stories you wrote. So bear with me, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to do an ad. It's The Killing Collective. The story is by Gary Starter, so hold on just a second.
Former Boston PD Captain Stanford Carter and his wife, forensic scientist Jill Seacrest, have decided to move to the Big Apple to accept positions with the New York branch of the FBI. Rookie agent Shania Deep Rose completes the trinity as they collide head-on with raging and rampant social, political, and economic unrest amid a string of murders that seem unrelated and may be serial, copycat, thrill, or hate-driven. As they struggle to understand the mind and thought process of the orchestrators, killers, and victims, the team begins to wonder who's who. The line between black and white, superior and subordinate, right and wrong, and good and evil disappears as they are forced to reevaluate their own thoughts, feelings, and philosophies. Ultimately, every character must come to their own conclusions to these questions. Is justice ever more important than the law? Is playing God justifiable if it's for the greater good of all? Come along for the ride to see if Agent Carter will decide to stick to being a hunter or become judge, jury, and executioner instead. Find the answers to these questions when you read the new book, The Killing Collective. The Killing Collective is a character-driven story with big characters with depth. They're soul-searching in addition to the biggest case of the agents' careers. The Killing Collective, available on Amazon in both Kindle and paperback editions. Order your copy today.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is The Killing Collective by author Gary Starter, and I highly recommend it. It will just blow you away. Tonight, our guest is author Cheryl Peyton, and if you're just now joining us, you will have to go back and listen to the archives, because she has lived a very, very exciting and storied life. And Wayne Zarrell, how in the world did you get hooked up with Wayne, because he's been on this show several times? He also is a transplant and a retired cop, and he loves it up there where y'all are. He just never anything anymore.
Well, I know Wayne through we're in the same organization, the Authors Guild of Tennessee, and Wayne told several of us about your show and encouraged us, you know, to contact you if we were interested. I hope that you'll get some other authors from our group. We have some wonderful writers. We've got about 40 people in our organization.
Wow.
And, So, and I was actually one of the co-founders, so I was there when it was two.
and one other.
And so, yeah. And he's still in the organization. So, and that was about six, seven years ago. Yeah.
Well,
so
I think that is I think that is a fantastic thing that y'all have done up in that area, because it's it's hard enough for us as indie authors to get exposure. I was I started way back when people laughed at us, and I thought, yeah, okay, we'll see who's laughing in a couple of years. And to have a organization where like minds can meet and express their ideas and network. That's the biggest thing is networking as an indie author. So congratulations that it's lasted 6 years.
Oh, it's thriving. We're getting new people all the time, and a couple people have to drop out because they move away or whatever happens. But our primary goal is to market together because, you know, there's how many millions of books even on Amazon. I used to know the number. Well, it changes every 10 minutes. There's another. But so anyway, so we make a bigger presence in the marketplace. Plus, you know, advertising or appearing at fairs and festivals and so on is much more affordable because we, you know, can put our money together and do the shows and so on. So we, you know, we really enjoy and we learn from each other. Yeah, it's a very good organization. I'm proud to be a member.
Well, I am glad that he sent you to me because you, my dear, have some magnificent stories. Now, ladies and gentlemen, y'all cannot go look her up yet. You're going to miss it all if you do. The 6 minutes to midnight, that book could be headline news in the real world because things like that happen all the time. Let's talk about that book for a minute. Let's talk about that for a minute. A, what made you go in that direction? And B, how did you hook up with the gentleman that became your mentor and consultant?
Yeah, Bill Harris is his name. Well, in 2010, I'd been here for about 6 years, but they were going to take the census. So I decided to apply to the government for that job of going around taking the census of people who hadn't returned their forms. You know, it's not everybody. It's the people who haven't returned their forms. So I thought, well, it'd be interesting, and I would learn more about, I would meet more people in the countryside and learn more about the area. And so I took the test, and I was hired. And Bill Harris, who was a retired nuclear weapons courier, was in my small pod. And, in fact, he was like the leader. And he would accompany some of the women on occasion when we had to go to areas that, you know, were maybe very remote. We were a little nervous about, you know, going into the backwoods and so on. And, again, we are taking the census of people who didn't want to return the form. So you might be running into a little antagonism. And there you show up. I'm from the government. And so anyway, so I got to know Bill because he would ride along with me a couple of times, and we got to talking, and he told me about his occupation as a courier for nuclear weapons and all about Y-12, and I didn't know about the program of them transporting fissile material and weaponry on the highways in these caravans, in these convoys of three, you know, it's sort of a secret. I mean, you can find out about it. I don't mean that, but it's little known. Let's put it that way. I didn't know about that. And so it got me to thinking. And then he had written a short story, because he's not a writer. He's a military man. And he had written a short story that supposed to be an attack on a nuclear weapons convoy, but it was a military exercise. But he didn't name any of his characters. They were just men jumping out from behind trees and shooting at each other. I said, well, Bill, you have to give backstories to these people. You have to name them. We have to care about who dies, you know? And he said, well, you write it. I said, well, okay, I will. And so I did. I started writing the book. I wrote, you know, he dared me to write a book. And so I wrote the first chapter, and I was so interested in what was going to happen, I had to write a second chapter. And then I got into it, and I thought, I want to see what, you know, this is a great story. I can make this story. And I put a female character in because, you know, it's kind of a hefty masculine subject, and I didn't want to lose the females who would read a book because, you know, 80% of fiction readers are women.
Mm-hmm.
So I used my protagonist in that book is a young, attractive, of course, 30-ish woman named Dana. And so she became my central character. And then she crosses paths with this, you know, psychopathic character. And that sets off a chain of events that leads to an attack on her convoy, although she survives. But then she's instrumental in, you know, running him to ground because she can put some clues together. And so it's a very exciting tale. And I had to learn all about nuclear weapons. You can imagine I started out knowing nothing. I mean, I don't know what you know about nuclear weapons, but I didn't know where the titanium, the plutonium, and everything is in the core and how you break the code for the PAL lock, the permissive action link, and all that. And so I was doing all this research, you know, on the computer. I love to do research. I did that, you know, as a paralegal a lot, legal research. And so I would do all this research, and I'd think, here I am going on the computer every day for hours. You know, how can you get inside a nuclear weapon? How do you break the codes? And who has the codes and all this stuff? I was surprised, you know, NSA didn't show up at the door because I did that for hours until I could learn enough because it's hard to get a lot of material on that. So,
right, because
anyway.
It's supposed to be top secret.
Yeah, all this is top secret. In fact, the commander at Y-12 had to read my book to see if I stumbled on anything that could be classified. Apparently,
wow.
I didn't. Yeah.
Wow.
So, because I do
That's
have a new...
Yeah,
it was. So, anyway, and Bill, I would send my chapters to Bill Harris, and then he would say, no, that isn't how you hold that weapon, like I was an idiot. And so he had to teach me a lot about that because I don't know much about guns. I really wasn't very well prepared to write a book of this nature. And, you know, still today I'm amazed, frankly, that I wrote it, and I think it's pretty good. So,
well, my philosophy is if you're going to do it, go big or go home.
That's right. And so I did. It was quite a challenge. I went
big.
I ended up with a 120,000-word book. It was,
wow.
You know, over three. Yeah, it was 340-some pages. I cut it back, and I've since even trimmed off some more. But, yeah, I ended up with quite a book. So for my first book. And then I kept writing, so I have to keep thanking Bill Harris all the time. I send him notes. Thank you so much for inspiring me to write. Because I don't know what would have happened if I hadn't met him. I mean, that whole chain of events was was just... stunning that I met him.
So would it be fair to say, Cheryl, that, and I believe in this because things have happened odd in my life, that people are put in our lives when we need them.
Yes. I did feel that that was really a special kismet moment, you know, meeting him and what he was about and that, you know, we got into talking about writing this book. It was wonderful.
And talking about kismet moments, see how we do this, ladies and gentlemen? It just circles back around. There was another kismet moment in your life that caused you to write Walk Through the Rain.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Tell us about that one.
Sure. There was a gal who lived down the street from me. This is right after I wrote 6 Minutes to Midnight, and her name was Cheryl, as my name is. And so we were friends, and when I wrote this book, she said, you know, I'd love for someone to write my story. because she had survived polio. She had contracted it as a three-year-old child. And all the events in her life that connected to that that terrible disease, that, and all that she went through. And as we got to talking, I couldn't believe, neither of us could, the synchronicity in our lives. We have the same maiden name. Our full names are exactly the same. Cheryl Carlson was my, and her maiden name. And as we talked further, parents had the same names. My dad and hers and her mom and mine are both Al and Dorothy, except my mom was called Dottie, but it's the same. We each have one sibling. Her birthday
wow.
is the same as my brother's, and her sister's is one day off mine. So it was real weird. She grew up in Minneapolis, and I grew up in Chicago. We're the same age. I mean, it's almost like we were interchangeable and that I should write her story. And I wrote it in first person. So I really did feel like I was writing my story.
And before the show, I said, y'all are doppelgangers. You've got to be doppelgangers. Because
yeah.
how odd is that that the parents are named the same?
Yes.
You have the
yes.
same first and last
yes.
maiden name.
Yes.
The birthdays are so close.
Yes.
Again, you were supposed to meet her and write her story through your eyes.
Yes. And as I had mentioned to you before the show, some of the, you know, the not the incidents, but just the general tone of life and activities and so on, of being a kid in the Midwest at that time of life, I could draw on my own experiences. You know,
right.
the games
right.
we used to play and, you know, going to camp and all the things that I did that were part of her life. Too. And what was interesting about writing her story, again, I knew nothing about polio. So you're supposed to write what you know. Well, not me. A lot of it I did know, but I didn't know much about the disease, really. And that research was difficult because, you know, the Salk vaccine came out in 1955, and polio has been eradicated in this country, in all countries except three. And in the world. And so I needed to go back into the 1940s to see what techniques doctors and therapists were using for on polio patients, what kinds of surgeries were being done. So that was kind of difficult. But what aided me was that her mother, Cheryl's mother, had saved every single hospital bill, every single hospital record, so I could draw on all that original source material, you know,
wow.
to put together the story. So I have exact dates for all the surgeries and when she came home and how long she was home from this surgery or that. She had 17 surgeries and still led a pretty normal life. She was a very courageous young gal, and she had a beautiful life, and she had friends, and she dated, and, you know, but there were a lot of problems that she had overcome that most of us didn't. You know, she was kept out of school a lot and had to be tutored, you know, at home and so on. So it was quite a different world. But I remember that world before the Salk vaccine. I wasn't allowed to swim in public pools, and my mother kept me away from groups of children I didn't know because there was this fear. I don't know that you're old enough to remember this, but it affected, and you know, it's only like a very small percentage of children who contracted polio got the paralytic strain, and there were three different types of paralytic strains, and the worst was the one that affected your lungs. Those were the children in the iron lungs, and Cheryl
mm-hmm.
was in that briefly. Because it seemed like it had gone higher up in her spinal cord. But anyway, that was a labor of love, and I got very involved in that as I say, part of my story too.
See, ladies and gentlemen, she just finds all these people that come into her life, and she's lived such a storied life. She could draw on her experiences as a social worker, a.k.a. interior designer, a.k.a. paralegal, and have one of her characters be involved in all of that. And speaking of cozy mystery, you do have a 5-story cozy mystery along Agatha Christie's lines. Now, for those of you who are too young to understand who Agatha Christie was, she was the premier female author / sleuth / mystery writer. And one could almost say she was the premier mystery cozy writer, too, because that's what she wrote.
Yeah. Well, she established the sort of sanitized murder mystery that was character-driven and that isolated a group of people, you know, to be a weekend house party, you know, she was British, of course, that, you know, would always have a colonel. I mean, some of her characters were, right? There was always a colonel coming back from India. And then she would have the, you know, young Debs and so wealthy people usually, but they also get murdered by Agatha Christie.
And she was an equal opportunity.
She would kill anybody. But what I enjoyed about them was the puzzle of putting together the clues that she would drop. She wouldn't surprise you at the end with something, you know, oh, well, she had an evil twin sister and that's who it was. you know, you could follow and figure it out or try to. And so I always enjoyed reading her and some of the others, Ruth Rendell I liked, and P.D. James, and, you know, but they all were interesting mysteries, too. And I think most people like mysteries. You know, that's generally the most popular genre. It still is, I think. And Agatha just had perfected it. She was also, she wrote so much. I don't know, something like 76 books.
Something like that.
And combination novelettes and so on. Yeah, I mean, she was prolific. And she wrote for many years. And she wrote in an interesting age for mysteries, too. You know, like train travel, you know, was sort of luxurious, you know. And going to India and her archaeological stories that are set in Egypt and so on. She was, you know, married to an archaeologist, to Archie Christie. So she was an interesting person, had led an interesting life. And I just like the whole idea of an isolated group of people so that you knew that your universe was very small as to your killer and your victim. So it was always, it was solvable and interesting.
So your cozy mystery involves a travel agent.
Right.
Continue.
So she is a 30-ish young woman named Alex Trotter, and she has Globetrotter Travels. And so following the Agatha Christie formula, she has this small group of people that she takes to various places around the world on vacation, and that's sort of black humor, you know, being murdered on vacation. And I sort of enjoyed that, too. And so, it's sort of sanitized. They find the body after the murder. And in fact, in my first book, which is set on what is really Cumberland Island that I call Bedford Island, it's an interesting place. They're staying in an old inn, which is very Christie-like. And the island itself is cut off from the mainland. There's not a bridge, so it's only approachable by boat. So we really have them isolated. And I forget my train of thought. I was going to tell you something about the story, and I can't remember what it was. But anyway, I know what it was. So the murder actually takes place during a live-action game of Clue. So I'm really going back to sort of that early kind of mystery game stories. And the body is found stabbed in the library. And so it really does follow.
Murdered by Colonel Mustard.
Yes, yes, that sort of thing, yes. Exactly right. So I really draw on those traditions.
When you started writing after you wrote 6 Minutes to Midnight and was literally baptized by fire in the literary world, go
yeah.
big or go home, did you have an idea of the genres you wanted to do, or are you open to anything?
Well, that's why I started writing mysteries, because talking about, you know, writing what you know, I had read a lot of mysteries because I always enjoyed them, you know. And I read other things, too, but that was primary. And so I thought I had a feeling for that, you know, because I was never involved in police work of any sort. But I felt I did have a feeling for that. I felt it was very natural and comfortable to write that kind of story. And also I've done a bit of traveling, and so I use destinations that I either know or are similar. My second book was a cruise, and of course I've taken on a large ocean liner down to the
uh-huh.
Caribbean. This is to Bermuda, not the Caribbean. I haven't been to Bermuda, but I use Google Earth, and so I went all around the island, you know, on Google Earth. And I've had more people tell me that it reminds them so much of their honeymoon and all these places. They remember that bar and everything. Well, I've never been there. And
but,
they said, you
the
just brought it to
life.
Yes. So, but other places I have, like Key West, Margaritaville is another one of my books, and I'm Murder in Montmartre, and that's in Paris. I have been there, but not for a long time. Murder on the Rhine, that's a Viking cruise down the Rhine. I've done that exact tour. So I knew all those tourist places and how that, so, you know, it's sort of a combination. And I'm writing a book in the series that's going to be Murder in Mobile, and it's going to take place in Mardi Gras, which is a big deal down in Mobile.
Uh-huh, it is.
Are you familiar with that? Well, you're.
Yes, it's very, very big.
Yes.
It's as big as one in New Orleans.
I know. It's just fascinating. I didn't know about that. But I did go down there. My husband and I went down there for a few days. And so, and this is going to be a reunion of Alex with her college friends. And I'm going to use my own college friends. So it's going to, I mean, I'm going to use their name. I got their approval. They're one of them asked to be the killer. So
word.
Yeah. So I'm going to involve her. I don't know that she's going to actually, but maybe. We'll see. We'll see.
See what the voices in your head tell you to do.
That's right. That's right. And always when I'm writing, and you've probably experienced this too, one or another of the characters that might have been a minor character when I started, I get more interested in. And they become, yeah, and I write more of a story with them because there's something that appeals to me about that particular character. So,
and they demand
fact,
to be heard.
Yes, I know. I know. They do live inside your head, don't they? They
yes,
can be annoying.
They
can
very
be annoying,
annoying
sometimes.
Worse
yeah.
than my children ever were.
But when I wrote my first book, I brought in a detective in the story, and I liked the rapport that he had with my character, Alex. And she was one of the first suspects. Well, they all were. I mean, you know, it was one of the 12 of them, so they all were. And so, of course, she resented that, and she decided she was going to do her own detective work. And that's when she started sleuthing, you know. But I liked the the conversations with these two. And so I brought him along in the next book and the next and the next. So there's a relationship that develops with this detective. Also gives me some authenticity, you know, about sort of wrapping up the case and making arrests and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because she's
You are not going to believe this, my dear, but we are getting to the end of our hour.
Oh.
I told you it would go by fast.
Oh, my
gosh. Tell the folks where you can be found and where your books can be found. No, y'all can't go yet. You have to wait a minute. Tell the folks where you can be found and where your books can be found.
Okay. Well, certainly on Amazon and on Barnes & Noble online, both of those, and then in local stores around Knoxville. That I don't know that you want me to give you those names, but gift stores and one bookstore in our area, in a three-county area around here.
Nice. Also, he's on Facebook with Peyton, P-E-Y-T-O-N.
Yes.
Now, I have a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Since we had so much fun this hour, would you be willing to come back on the show?
Oh, sure. I'd love to. It was fun.
Okay.
And it did go fast. You promised me that.
It does go fast. I get that reaction from everybody.
And I didn't even think about the 89,000 people that might be listening.
See? it's just you and I having a conversation.
Right.
So, ladies and gentlemen, tomorrow afternoon I will be doing a special show at 3 o'clock in the afternoon because my guest lives in Johannesburg, South Africa. Author Ian McKenzie will be on the show with me, so check that out. From 3 to 4 Eastern Standard Time, we will not do a show tomorrow night. Next week, I will have no shows because I will be out of town from Wednesday to Sunday, but we will be back the following week. But that doesn't mean you can't go and catch all the archives and encourage your friends to do that. There are three things I say at the end of my shows because I believe in them. I believe in each of you. I believe in my guest. And the only way we succeed is when we help each other. So with that being said, don't just feel special, be special, because if you just feel special, you will never be special. If you want to achieve greatness, please stop asking permission, ladies and gentlemen, because nobody is going to give it to you. Think about that. They're not going to give you permission to achieve greatness because they don't want to achieve greatness. They're happy in their mediocre lives. The difference between who you are today and who you want to be tomorrow is what you do today. So if you want to be somebody different tomorrow, then change what you do. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, you can change what you do and you can change who you are. Just because something happens in your life does not define you. It was a defining act, but it does not define who you are. Your smile is your logo, your personality is your business card, and how you leave others feeling after having had that experience with you, ladies and gentlemen, that is your trademark. And if you don't believe me, you know what journey someone is doing. We're all traveling a journey. We're all on a journey. We're all doing something. For some of us, it's a harder journey than for others. Because things happen in our lives. Sometimes it's not just a bump in a road. It's a whole damn boulder. And if we can't go through it, we find a way to go around it or over it. So be kind to each other and be kind to yourself. Be your best friend. Don't be your own worst enemy because that only gets in the way of you being successful. Never allow anyone to steal your dream without your permission. And don't give them permission. Because it's your dream. You own it. It's yours. Do not allow them to steal it. Because I'm going to tell you, I just want to thank all those people that told me no all those many years ago. I've been on international television twice. I've been on national television twice. I have 17 books out. I have my own radio show. I have my own design collection on video. So, yes, make your dream real. Take other people with you. Because we're only as successful as we help others to be. So with that being said, I want to thank my guest so much, Miss Cheryl Peyton, for joining me. It was a marvelous, marvelous adventure, and I cannot wait to do it again. And she has graciously agreed to come back. So join me tomorrow afternoon at 3 o'clock Eastern Standard Time when I interview South African author Kenzie. It should promised to be an interesting hour. So until then, this is your host, Yvonne Mason, with Off the Chain, and my guest, Cheryl Peyton, saying good evening.
Good night.
Now, Cheryl, we are off the live show. This is the archives, and what I'm telling you will show up in the archives, but that's okay. What I want to tell you, though, is as soon as we get off from here, the show will archive. I am going to put the link on my page. I'm going to tag you in that.
I'm sorry, you broke up. You're going to put the link where, Yvonne?
On my page. I'm going to put the link on my page, and I'm going to tag you in it. Take that link and put it everywhere, and then sometime tomorrow, after I get back from the radiologist, I'm going to put it up on SoundCloud, MixCloud, Spreaker, Podcast.com, and Podcast Garden. Once it uploads there, I will also tag you in those links. That's my gift to you, is to take all those podcasts and this show and promote this show tonight for yourself.
Oh, my goodness. Well, thank you so much. This has been a real pleasure, and I've enjoyed talking with you, and I thought you did a great job talking to me. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I told you the hour would just absolutely fly by.
I didn't believe that, I have to admit, but now I do. I'm a believer.
So now you can go back and tell Wayne, she was right, the hour flew by.
Right. Honestly, I couldn't believe when you said it was time. My goodness.
And we've been in the capacity for one to talk about. So if you will graciously come back and become a regular guest, because what will happen is you will get a following on this show.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. All right. Well, I'll have to think about new things to say and everything, but I won't disappoint you. I will.
Well, I have no doubt you won't disappoint. Darling, you're a natural, and you're writing new books, and you've got all this stuff that you're researching, and we can talk about your trips and more. See, we didn't even hardly touch the cozy mystery, so we got a lot to talk about.
Okay. Good enough.
So go enjoy your evening, and I will get this up and send it to you. And thank you so much. I had a ball.
Oh, thank you, Yvonne. Me too.
Talk to you later, honey. Good night.
Bye-bye.
Xfinity Mobile is a new kind of network designed to save you money while streaming your favorite music. Like that 90s jams playlist you've played 72 times today. It combines America's largest, most reliable 4G LTE with the most Wi-Fi hotspots. Get up to 5 lines of unlimited nationwide talk and text included with your Xfinity internet at no extra cost. All you pay for is data. Visit an Xfinity store or click now to see how much you can save with Xfinity Mobile. Restrictions apply. Requires Xfinity internet service. Equipment, taxes, fees, and other charges extra. Limited to 2 lines pending internet activation.